Here is Lillian's story. When the government put lockdown measures in place, numerous thoughts came to mind. I'm a tactile person, so the thought of not being able to hug everyone and giving tea and sympathy anymore was a little depressing. Giving comfort while social distancing is a challenge, therefore the power of words had to be put in play. I was told years ago that people always remember how you made them feel. I find voluntary work a blessing, and at least I am allowed to go out and be busy. I've still been active. It is also amazing how many people come forward to be volunteers. Plus, it's wonderful how they come together during the crisis, donating time, money and food. People actually take time to speak, and life has continued at a slower pace. Food Bank and Port Grocery are doing amazing work, supporting families, vulnerable people, elderly, and those with underlying health issues. When the pandemic is over and we look back at how people responded, I pray that some of the good things of lockdown will continue. Compassion, thoughtfulness, and caring for the lonely and vulnerable.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Susanna, and I've just got something I'd like to share. Before I start, I'd just like to thank everyone in the Salvation Army in Ellesmere Port for making this possible, and also my close friends who've been so supportive, even though I know they don't agree with my beliefs. So all of you guys, thank you very much for being part of my journey. We moved up here last year, the idea being that I would work to support Dave because he's got health issues, and we've been nearer to our family up here and able to see them, and our daughter could visit all of us at once. Seemed like a good plan at the time. I'm great at good plans. So up we came, and it was a horrific journey, but we got here, and within a week or so I'd found a job. Well, I found a couple actually, but this one was working in a nursing home. Now, I've been in care for years, but I didn't particularly want to carry on with it. But I thought, well, it'll do for now, until I can find something that I really want to do. Because I'm a great fixer. I like to fix things. And, you know, money needs to come in. They can't work, so I'm going to be the one to earn it. And, you know, we've had loads of problems over the years, health-wise, with Dave mainly, which have caused financial problems, housing problems, etc. And I've always got to work to sort it out. So I've done one job, two job, three jobs, worked long shifts, done whatever I can to fix it. And it's never really worked. We just go from solving one problem to finding another, and then I'll do my best to solve that, and then there's another. And it's just like everybody's lives, really, I suppose, except that I was absolutely adamant I was going to fix it by myself. Because that's I'm stubborn, and that's what I do. I decide I'm going to fix something, I'm going to fix it. And I don't really like taking no for an answer or failing at anything. But I had to take no, because I think that God has been trying to stop me for years. Looking back, I can see little markers where he's just gone kind of like, whoa, now, you know, stop this now. And I've ignored it, totally ignored it. Nope, I can do it myself. I can do it. And now all of a sudden I couldn't. You know, I had an accident which resulted in a spinal injury, loss of control of my foot and lower leg, and quite a lot of pain, despite being on more painkillers than I'd like to think how it costs you an NHS, but there we are. They're kind of necessary in my case, really, for me to move, but there I was anyway, not after sympathy. Struggling, applying for benefits, not knowing what I was doing. It's a total minefield if you don't know what you're doing. People at the job centre were very helpful, you know, like absolutely brilliant, in fact. But, you know, it wasn't what I was used to. I wanted to fix it myself and I couldn't. And we had nothing, not enough coming in, and we ended up with a food voucher. One of three places we could redeem it. First place, nope, Dave wasn't going there. I can't drive at this point, obviously. Bad leg. Can't get behind the wheel of a car. Second one, nope, he wasn't going there either. So on the Friday, I said, right, now this is the Salvation Army. If we don't go here, we have no food for the weekend. Dave loves food. So off we trottled to the Salvation Army. Me in my wheelchair, in we go. Get a trolley load of food. It was great. Thanks, guys. You know, the food voucher system is amazing. Kept us going for a week, not 3 days. And then I can't even remember quite how it happened, but we were... said, well, there's a snack and chat in there, coffee, biscuits, toast if you want it. Go in, sit down, warm up, because it was a horrible, cold, wet, freezing day. So when we went, and we got chatting to Mike, first of all, I think, and then Diane and Dave. And I don't even know the subject came up, but we somehow agreed to come to the meeting on Sunday. We've both been brought up in the church. We've just kind of, like, lost connection, I think would be a good way to describe it. We hadn't stopped believing, but we weren't doing anything proactive about it in the language whatever of today. So we came to the meeting on the Sunday and we thoroughly enjoyed it. It was great. And we came back again and again, and we brought our grandchildren, and they loved it. And the first few times I was a watcher. I was looking in and thinking, well, I used to have this, but I don't have it anymore. I wish I did, but I don't, and I'd like to get it back. And that was kind of as far as it went. And then we were still applying for stuff, and we were still trying to get things, you know, just enough to pay our rent and feed us, basically. gas, electric, whatever. You know, we didn't want fast cars, foreign holidays, just enough to live on. And living is expensive these days. It's not cheap. And it got to the point where I was just taken over by this lethargy. I couldn't do anything. I couldn't fill in the form, I couldn't pick up the phone, I just could not do anything. And I can remember coming to the snack and chat and talking to Diane. And she said, well, how's it going, you know, with the housing and stuff? And I said, well, it isn't. I'm not doing anything. I know I should be, but I'm not. I'm just sitting here on my behind waiting for a miracle. And she said, well, then you'll get one. And she took my hands and she prayed for me and with me. And I was a bit emotional, I think, at the time. And that was that. And the following week, we were literally down to our last £9. And, you know, the rent was coming up, and it's not £9. It was when we first got married. It's not now. And that was £9 a week. But, you know, it just, we didn't have the money. And I'm thinking, what do we do? What do we do? And I got up in the morning, and I don't know why, I looked at the bank account on my phone. I shouldn't have been expecting it to change. I wasn't expecting anything to go in, but it had. I'd been awarded the PIP, and they'd back paid me to when I started the claim, which wasn't that long ago, but it was still enough to pay the rent that month. And I just could not believe it. I was just so grateful. And I think from then was when I realised that I couldn't fix this by myself. I've been trying for years to fix things, and I think God had been trying to stop me a lot of the time, and I just hadn't listened. I'm very stubborn, and I'd moved away, and I wasn't listening at all. And in the end, he said, right, well, now you have to listen to me. You can't work. You can't do this. You can't run around. You can't do stuff. You have to listen. You have to let me help. And so we did. And it's just kind of been on the up from there, really. However, when the lockdown started, I was afraid. I thought, I'm new back to this. I'm not going to be able to sustain it. I'm not having the fellowship. How am I going to sustain it? But I underestimated all my friends, because Susan said to me, there's a Bible app you can put on your phone now. All right, I fished around a few till I found a couple I liked. I have one on my phone now. I do it in the morning. I do evening prayers in the evening. I have podcasts I listen to in the day. I was, and this is bizarre really and very stupid, but I was terrified of telling my friends. Most of them aren't believers. We're good friends. Don't get me wrong. We've been through thick and thin together, work, families, everything. But I was afraid to tell them. And I really don't know why. But I did. And they were amazing. And then the next step was to stick it on Facebook, because a lot of my Facebook friends are quite scathing of religion, anything to do with religion. And I just kind of skip past those posts, you know, and I don't get involved in them. I'm just like, yeah, don't like the look of that, keep going. But I got so much support on Facebook as well, just people that I didn't think would ever think, you know, say to me, Susanna, that's okay. You know, we're happy with it as long as it's good for you, you know, and you can put whatever you like, wherever you like, and we will go along with it. We're fine with it. We're not going to challenge you. And I was just like, whoa, that's just amazing. Not that I'm afraid of them challenging me. I can pick a fight or stand up for myself in a fight as well as the next guy, but I don't like confrontation anymore. I used to. I used to court it. I used to pick arguments with people just because I like a heated debate, but not when it's something that special and that personal. And I didn't have the answers at this point. And then one of my friends said to me, you say what you like. We love you anyway. And if you're afraid you don't have the answers and you believe in God, then you have to trust your God to give the answers to you at that time. And I thought, take someone who doesn't believe to tell me how to believe. It's quite funny, really. But yeah. And it's just been amazing since then, and our faith has grown. And it does seem sometimes as if I'm dragging Dave along in my wake, but I'm not. Dave doesn't go where he doesn't want to be and doesn't do what he doesn't want to do. It's as simple as that. It always looks like I'm the boss in this relationship, but I'm not, because he does not do what he doesn't want to. I cannot make him. Nobody can make him except Jesus. And I think Jesus is the one that's bringing us back in. Or has brought us back in and is keeping us there. And walking by his side and him walking by our sides It's the best thing that's ever happened to us. And we thank everyone that's been involved in it, everyone that's been an instrument of God. Thank you very, very, very much. And I'm rambling on now, so I'll go. But this is my story. As the hymn says, this is my story, this is my song, praising my Saviour all the day long. And I'll leave it there.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, ring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long, praising my Savior all the day long.
Ta-da! Sorry, that's a bit of a shock. Those of you who are old enough will probably recognise the music played just before this, which was from Robinson Crusoe, very famous children's programme, dubbed from German into English, but a great piece of music. So, hopefully that'll have made you laugh, and this won't have scared you too much. I'm keeping it until this COVID pandemic is over. Out of interest? Okay. Right, so, my story. I'll give you the timeline first of all. So, May 2016, I walk into Ellesmere Port Salvation Army to help start up a new Singing for the Brain group for the Alzheimer's Society. June 2016, it didn't take me long, I realised that this church was now home. September 2017, I enrolled as a soldier, despite telling Louise that I would never be a soldier, and if I did, I would never wear the uniform. Foolish boy. Mid-2018, I felt the call to officership. November 2018, I was appointed the Corps Secretary. And then May 2019, I finally, after months of preparation, because it's a big document, submitted my application to become a Territorial Envoy. A TE, as they say. And then recently, 28th of May 2020, I attended my selection conference. We did it by video phone. It was very well organised. Very good. And then on the Friday, the 29th, I got a telephone call from Noreen and Roger, our divisional leaders, to say that they weren't going to recommend me to go forward to the candidates board as a TE, which came as a bit of a shock. In some ways, but in other ways, as you'll hear, God's got this. It's not a problem. So, a little about the journey. Well, if you look at that timeline, it would be easy and understandable to feel some sadness on my behalf. From a human perspective, it had been a long, long journey. And seemingly, now at the end, there was nothing. But that would be wrong, I can guarantee it. The lovely thing is that so many people have been in touch with me, not only to offer their commiserations for not getting through, but more importantly, to say how pleased they are that I am sticking around. So that's nice. It really cheered me up. So, looking back can truly be a two-edged sword. And I guess part of that contradiction comes from why we're looking back in the first place. If you remember in the Bible, Lot's wife looked back and she was turned into a pillar of salt, which seemed a little harsh, to be honest. But she had been warned, and maybe for her, the real problem wasn't the action, but rather the attitude. Was she looking back on a life that she still wished she had? We don't know. Then again, we're constantly reminded in the Bible to look back and remember. To remember God's faithfulness, to remember his leading, to remember his love. And in those cases, looking back acts as a reminder for the present that God really does care and only wants the best for us and for the future. And it's a reminder that no matter how black things look, no matter how much they seem to be going pear-shaped, he has it all under his control. Or to put it in a simpler phrase, God's got this. Taking all that into account, I need to firstly thank everyone for their genuine concerns. But please do not feel sorry for me on my behalf. Yes, it's been a long, tough road, and it has always been an adventure, a great adventure. And I've said and repeated it many, many times throughout that all I wanted was what God wanted, whatever and wherever that may be. Now, I must admit that I was speaking mainly about where I'd be placed on my first appointment. But truly, it extended beyond that to whatever God wanted me to do. Whatever, literally. So, having reached the end of this particular path, there's no way I can say anything than echo Jesus' words just before he was arrested in the garden. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done, O Lord. And interestingly, I actually adopted that as my life verse at the beginning of 2020. And I don't believe that was a coincidence. So no, there's really no need to feel sorry for me, because I'm not. I was and am happy to be wherever he places me. And as Susan very wisely said, you weren't turned down, you were turned around and redirected where you need to be. And that is spot on, Susan. Thank you. But there is another side to looking back, and that has the potential to be a complete and utter waste of time. But also, unless we're careful, we can end up just confused and misled by our own intellect. The positive option is looking back to see if there are any lessons we could learn or hints that God dropped about the future, maybe to help prepare us for an unexpected turn. And from that aspect, I would say that two things strike me. Firstly, during the many, many discussions and chats about the future of the core at Ellesmere Port, the common thread, and certainly during the last 12 months, was being, okay, what will happen when, and note the when, not if, when Lawrence goes. Now, it's not that I'm any more indispensable than anybody else, and there's a poem I'll read later which says that perfectly. But we're our small team. All of us put together, there's only really a few of us. And I'm not just talking about me and Susan and Jane. I'm talking about everybody that's a part of the church. We are a small team, and the loss of any one individual is going to leave a hole. And there's certainly more to do and more than could be done than any one officer can do. Jane, as did Louise and other officers before her, really needs our ongoing loving support and encouragement and prayers. So, yes, my moving on would create a gap, at least in the short term. And we talked around a number of options, but never really came to any firm conclusions. And thinking about that was slightly odd, especially we're all sure that God has work for us all to do at the Corps in Ellesmere Port for a very long time, and I'm in no doubt whatsoever about that. The second was interesting because its significance only became clear, as with all the best hints, afterwards. There are those of you who are familiar with the Army's candidates process, and you'll know that the assessment conference covers a lot of aspects. It's quite a big event. Apart from all the panel and the individual interviews and the role play, there's a 10-minute sermon to preach on any passage or subject of the candidate's choosing. Now, interestingly, and this seems to happen a lot with me lately, I don't know why and I don't know how long it'll carry on, but the Lord seems to give me passages to preach on months in advance. Maybe just so I get a chance to get it ready. I don't know. What I didn't know was when he wanted me to use this particular passage. But then I realised as it came closer that it was meant for the conference. So then I had the blessing and the pleasure of developing my sermon around 1 Kings 19 verses 9 to 14. Now I'll let you go and look that up. I'm not going to read it here now. And that's actually 6 verses, which is all you're allowed. I actually cheated. I added on a couple at the end by including them in the sermon. That was just for completeness. But anyway, just to save you going to get your Bible, this is the passage where Elijah has had the triumphant showdown with the priests of Baal. And that's followed by Jezebel threatening to kill him. So not surprisingly, Elijah legs it first into the desert and finally to Mount Horeb. Interestingly, that's the same mountain where Moses saw the burning bush and was later given the Ten Commandments. Anyway, there he hides in a cave, and then there come 2 conversations between him and God. And then God gives a spectacular display of power at the entrance to the cave. And that's in the middle of the 2 conversations. I won't spoil it, you can go look for yourself, but it did inspire the hymn that includes those words, "Let sense be dumb, let flesh retire, speak through the earthquake, wind and fire, O still small voice of calm." And interestingly, that has been one of my favourite hymns ever since childhood. Anyway, after those conversations, God gives Elijah specific instructions on what to do next. And here I'll simply quote what I said in my sermon. God's next step in these times with people is very often to go and do something specific. It's no different in us in this case, and it's so true in our lives. We sit at Jesus' feet and just enjoy his company. We're refreshed and reinvigorated, but more importantly, we are realigned. Our perspective, which so often becomes blinkered and narrow or short-sighted, is reset, and then God sets us on a new path. Sometimes forward, sometimes in a new direction, and sometimes, as in this case, back the way we came. But above all, it is where God wants us to go. What does Elijah do? He goes and does exactly what he was told to do. And that's a lesson for all of us. We don't need to worry about other stuff we don't know yet. Just trust God and do what he tells us to do. Now, although I didn't pick up on that "go back the way you came" message at the time, I can now see clearly that God was preparing the ground spiritually for the outcome that was yet to come. True, I didn't get that at the time, but it has been a major part of confirmation to me that the panel's decision was the correct one. It really was God's plan. And that has helped, if any help was needed, to take away any sense of upset or disappointment I may have felt. Again, to be truthful, I did have a fleeting moment of sore ego a few days later, but that passed. So, a long journey resulting in my staying here in the port with all this other motley crew. And I'm genuinely pleased about that. But what about the journey? And here I'll quote a little of the message I sent to the chairman of the assessment panel shortly after I'd been informed of the result by Noreen and Roger. "I'm confident that all of the candidates have said from the very beginning, 'Not my will, but thine be done, O Lord.' I'm equally certain that my walk needed to go via this last week and the assessment conference. I was blessed so much by the experience and would not have changed that for the world. The key point for me is that the whole process, and the assessment conference in particular, has been filled with God's presence and his love and leading in everyone that took part, and above all, his blessing. So, the end of one journey, but the beginning of another. I'm honoured that I will be a part of our journey together into whatever God has planned for us all in Ellesmere Port. How long that will be for, I have no idea. But I will say one thing. When Brenda was promoted to glory in 2015, I was so grateful that with God's help, I was able to look after her to the end. It had been a long 15 years with lots of ups and downs. And after she was gone, there was a little voice telling me that I needed to just go somewhere for 3 months. And it was always 3 months. But then there was the funeral and the probate and the will to sort out. I also just kept going to the dementia groups that we used to attend, but now as a helper and eventually as a volunteer. And it was that that led me into the Salvation Army. And the rest of this, as they say, is history. Many of you will have read or heard me talk about my recognition of the fact that I needed some bereavement counselling during that first year. But typically for me, and I suspect many people, we just keep going. And I finally got to the point on my own where I was in enough control of the grieving process to just get along. That wasn't good. Again, it was my journey towards territorial envoyship that made me look at my whole emotional and mental health. And that in itself prompted me to seek help. That again was confirmed by the candidates process, which suggested that I do need to seek counselling. So once more, maybe that was how God used the journey to get me to where I needed to be. I don't know. Who knows? I'm certainly aware that the counselling is being hugely beneficial, so that's good. But it was also interesting that the counselling process had brought this idea of getting away back to the table. I knew that a break like that would be very helpful, but I just couldn't see how God was going to fit that into the schedule and get me to wherever my posting would be without some major interruption and disruption. So I put it to one side. Of course, now the future is clearer. I'm not surprised that a sabbatical has come back as an option. It's early days yet, but sometime in 2021 could well be a good time frame. That will allow us all to recover after the disturbance of COVID-19, work out how our little group will operate best, and see where the exciting Team Spirit project takes us. I really am so excited that I'll now be a part of that whole area of work, and I can easily see that having teams set up and running will mean that I could almost be redundant by the time my break happens. Certainly for a lot of practical activities that currently take up so much time, but are in themselves actually vital for our mission here in the community. So, we will see how and where God leads on both counts. But I wouldn't be surprised if my break included some combination or permutation of motorbikes, tall ships and Japan. Not necessarily all at once and not necessarily in that order. And by the way, if anyone would like to read my assessment conference sermon, just let me know. Or maybe I'll do it sometime for everyone to hear, I don't know. But one thing I should add is that for a bit of fun and with a serious side, I did record a spoof assessment conference interview that you can see on YouTube. I did for a very short while seriously consider whether to make that my proper sermon instead, but it was a little too long. And it's probably just as well I didn't do it. When you see it, you will understand. But that's my story. Well, a portion of it anyway. It's an ongoing process, as with all of us. God, once again, has been faithful. And who knows where we will go next under his guidance. But wherever it is, it's going to be great. Thank you for listening. And this is the poem I mentioned. It's called The Indispensable Man, and I would add on, or woman. Sometime when you're feeling important, sometime when your ego's in bloom, sometime when you take it for granted you're the best qualified in the room, sometime when you feel that your going would leave an unfillable hole, just follow these simple instructions and see how they humble your soul. Take a bucket and fill it with water. put your hand in it up to the wrist. Pull it out, and the hole that's remaining is a measure of how much you'll be missed. You can splash all you wish when you enter. You may stir up the water galore. But stop, and you'll find that in no time it looks quite the same as before. The moral of this quaint example is to do just the best that you can. Be proud of yourself, but remember, there's no indispensable man. Thank you. God bless. Okay, so this is part two. This is my song. I could have chosen a myriad, but this one seemed particularly appropriate. And you may have heard it. It's The Climb by a young lady, as she was then, Miley Cyrus. And I know this is quite an unusual choice. And I couldn't even honestly say it's my favourite. It isn't, but it just seems so appropriate to this. And it means a lot to me. As you just heard, the last 3 years have felt like a bit of a climb for me, with its ups and downs, crossing the occasional chasm, taking a leap of faith, jumping a ravine, trusting that the rope that is holding me will carry on holding me. And having come to the end of that journey, I can see why people might think, or expect me to think, well, that was a waste of time and effort, doing all that, not getting anywhere at the end. You're back where you started from. But as I've said, that would be so far from the mark. Those of you who are bikers at heart, and by that I mean ones with engines, proper motorbikes, will know that it's never about the destination. It's all about the journey. An avid motorcyclist, assuming they've actually got a bike that is A, in one piece, and B, on the road — that bit's just for Colin and for Malcolm, that'll make him laugh — they will know that they're quite happy to just jump on the bike, ride around in what essentially is a big circle, and come back to where they started and do nothing in between apart from ride the motorbike. Now, to some people, that too would be a complete and utter waste of time and petrol. Again, they'd be wrong, because it's not about the destination. It's all about the journey. It's all about the climb. Enjoy.
I can almost see it, that dream I'm dreaming, but there's a voice inside my head saying you'll never reach it. Every step I'm taking, every move I make feels lost with no direction. My faith is shaken, but I gotta keep trying. Gonna keep my head held high. There's always gonna be another mountain. I'm always gonna wanna make it move. Always gonna be an uphill battle. Sometimes I'm gonna have to lose. It ain't about how fast I get there. I'm facing the chances I'm taking. Sometimes I knock me down, but no, I'm not breaking. I may not know it, but these are the most.